Well, greetings, everyone, and welcome to this third program of the year in the Sacred Music Series offered by the Harvard Catholic Forum. I am Deacon Tim O'Donnell, Director of the Forum, and I'm happy to welcome you, both you who are with us here in person at St. Paul's in Harvard Square, and those joining us by live stream. The Harvard Catholic Forum engages the Catholic intellectual and cultural tradition through lectures, non-credit courses, master classes, reading groups, and a week-long summer seminar. Co-sponsor for the Forum's Sacred Music Series is the St. Paul's Choir School, the only Catholic boys' choir school in the United States, and a vehicle of inspiring sacred music both here at St. Paul's Church and in concerts around the world. This afternoon, we bring you two speakers who combine perspectives from theology, history, liturgy, and musicology to bring out both the beauty and the liturgical meaning of one of the most beloved of all Mass settings, Palestrina's Missa Papae Marcelli. We will then join in a contemporary Mass in which this beautiful music will raise up and give particular expression to the mystery of the Eucharist. Both the lecture and the Mass will be archived on the Harvard Catholic Forum website, YouTube channel. Please share that link with friends and colleagues who would be interested in watching and hearing the recording later. You can learn more about the Harvard Catholic Forum on the Forum's website at harvardcatholicforum.org, where you can register for future events, watch archived programs, and support an important mission by making a financial contribution. The lecture segment this afternoon will last 40 minutes or so, and then we will have an opportunity for some Q&A. Those of you who are here in person should have received a note card and pencil when you came in. If you have a question, please write it on the card. At about 5 o'clock, one of our colleagues from the forum will come up the aisles and collect the cards and bring them to me. I will pass on as many of the questions as I can. Unfortunately, we are not set up technically to take questions from our virtual audience at the same time. From 5:20 to 5:30, we will have a break while the choir assembles and the ministers prepare for the Mass. Feel free to get up and stretch your legs. There are restrooms directly across the bridge, which is out that door. You should have received an order of service when you came in. Inside is a simple survey that you can do with your pencil in 2 minutes, or if you wish, you can use the QR code on it and fill out the survey online. Please, please help us to evaluate and improve our programs by doing this survey. Hard copies will be picked up as you leave. And please join us after the Mass for a reception in the student lounge. You can reach it by crossing the bridge over there, or you can go out the door at the rear of the church, take a hard right, and enter the parish center on the right. We look forward to greeting you and promise that no one will go home hungry. This afternoon, two speakers share the podium. The first is Father John Baldovin, a Jesuit priest and professor of historical and liturgical theology at the Boston College School of Theology and Ministry. He will explore the context in which Palestrina composed this music for a Eucharistic liturgy by addressing doctrine and music before and after the Council of Trent. Father Baldovin, whose PhD is from Yale, has written and taught internationally on the history and theology of the liturgy, the sacraments, and ministry, both for scholars and for a broader public. He is past president of the North America Academy of Liturgy. We are especially pleased to be welcoming Father Baldovin back to St. Paul's, where he was a regular guest celebrant of the Eucharist for some years. Our second speaker is James Kennerley, Director of Music at the St. Paul's Choir School and here at St. Paul's Harvard Square. Rooted in the English choir school tradition, He is an internationally known organist, vocalist, and director. Educated at the other Cambridge, Mr. Kennerley was organ scholar at Jesus College and later at St. Paul's Cathedral in London. He has frequently given solo organ concerts throughout the US and Europe. His talk will address the music itself and the way of integrating that music into a contemporary mass. Please join me in welcoming Father Baldovin.
Thank you, Deacon Tim, and good evening, everyone. The Council of Trent, which lasted from 1547 to 1563, is by any account one of the major events in the life of the Church. It met in three sessions in the Alpine city of Trent and the northern Italian city of Bologna, which at the time were both part of the Holy Roman Empire. The musical setting for the Mass, which we will hear today in the context of the liturgy, was composed, as you know, by Giovanni Pierluigi da Palestrina, probably in 1562 in honor of Pope Marcellus II, who reigned for only a month in 1555. One of the major issues that Trent dealt with was the defense of the Catholic doctrine of the sacraments against what was, or was perceived to be, the theological critique of the Protestant reformers. Of the seven sacraments that the Church had enumerated ever since the 12th century, the most important, of course, is the Eucharist, and the Eucharist received the most attention during the three sessions of the Council. My aim this afternoon is to discuss the major themes of Trent's teaching on the Eucharist, as well as Trent's guidelines for reforming the Mass, so that we can put the Mass that we're about to celebrate and the Missa Papae Marcelli in historical context. I well realize that the Mass this afternoon is not the rite that was approved after the Council of Trent, as I'm sure Master Kennerley will explain very well. That was approved in 1570 by Pope Pius V. So, first, allow me to put the Council of Trent in some context, a broader context. Trent was envisioned as a council to reform the Church. There had been many calls to reform the Church in head, meaning the Pope, head and members since the Great Western Schism, a split in the papacy that began in the 14th century. That schism ended with the Council of Constance in 1415 to 1417. But at the time, church leaders recognized the need for ongoing reform. The reform was only beginning. A subsequent council, less known, I think, the Council of Florence, met from 1439 to 1445. This council was called to heal two other schisms that had existed for centuries between the Roman Church and the Byzantine Church on the one hand and the Armenian Church on the other. One of the major documents of the Council of Florence was its decree for union with the Armenians. The decree contained a summary of the Catholic Church's teaching on the seven sacraments, a summary that relied very heavily on the theology, in fact, digested the theology of St. Thomas Aquinas. Now, with regard to the Eucharist, the Council affirmed the following, and I quote, "It is by the power of these words," the words of institution, by Christ at the Last Supper, "it is by the power of these words that the substance of bread is changed into the body of Christ and the substance of wine into his blood in such a way, however, that the whole Christ is contained under the species of bread and the whole Christ under the species of wine." Here we find the Catholic Church's teaching on the Lord's real presence in the consecrated bread and wine in a nutshell. It was left to the Council of Trent to expand and deepen the Church's doctrinal teaching on all of the sacraments, especially the Eucharist. The pressing motive for these formal doctrinal declarations was, of course, the challenge to the whole edifice of traditional teaching posed by the various factions of the Protestant Reformation. At the same time, we should not ignore the fact that Trent was also called for the positive purpose of ongoing reform. More of this later with regard to the Mass itself and sacred music. Now, the challenges posed by the Protestant reformers like Martin Luther, Ulrich Zwingli, and John Calvin differed among themselves. But since Trent's decrees never named these individuals explicitly, I'll feel free not to differentiate among them. Four issues raised by the Protestants concern us here and concern the Council. One, the nature of the sacraments themselves. Two, the real presence of our Lord in the Eucharistic elements. Three, the sacrifice of the Mass. And four, the use of the vernacular and communion under both kinds. I should mention here that the conciliar meetings consisted of considerable debate among the various theologians of various theological schools. But the Council Fathers, and I think this is important, the Council Fathers deliberately chose not to enter into specific theological debates among the schools. Rather, they wanted to profess doctrine. Doctrine always needs to be interpreted by theologians in different times, places, and circumstances. So it was then, so it is today. This choice, their choice not to choose among the schools, will be reflected when we come to the question of Eucharistic sacrifice in particular. So, first, with regard to the nature of the sacraments in its seventh session, in 1547, the Council contented itself with a series of 13 canons, namely brief statements, which clarified what Catholics must affirm, as well as condemning statements considered erroneous, or to use their language, anathematized. For our purpose, the most pertinent of these canons are canons 6, 7, and 8. And taken together, or lumped them together, these canons affirm the objectivity of the sacraments, when properly celebrated, and their effectiveness for those who receive them without putting any obstacle in the way, namely sin or lack of faith. The usual tag for this teaching is the Latin phrase ex opere operato. That is, when properly celebrated, the sacraments always enjoy the guarantee that God is genuinely offering grace, that is to say, life with God. They do so, the sacraments do so, in various manners, and they are meant to increase our life in God, for example, restoring our peace with God and the Church after serious sin in the sacrament of penance. Simply put, God can really be counted on to act in the Church's own sacramental celebrations. And let me add that this effectiveness is conditioned by our own dispositions. God's gift is objective and secure. But the manner in which it becomes effective in our own lives depends on our own receptivity. I've spent some time on this important doctrinal affirmation because it has direct relevance to what the Council has to say about the real presence. 4 years passed before the Council issued its decree on the sacrament of the Eucharist in 1551. There, in no uncertain terms, the Council affirmed the objective real presence of the Lord in the consecrated bread and wine. Thus, in the language of the Council, the Eucharist is unique, not only because it conveys divine grace, but because it contains the Lord himself, body and blood, soul and divinity. The decree and the corresponding canon use the term, familiar term, transubstantiation, to describe the miraculous conversion of the whole substance of bread and wine into the substance of Christ's body and blood. Now, the fathers of Trent were well aware that transubstantiation was a technical term. On the one hand, transubstantiation accurately affirms the objective sacramental conversion. But on the other, and in line with the extremely sophisticated theology of St. Thomas Aquinas, transubstantiation as a term also avoids a crude sort of physicalist understanding of the Lord's presence, breaking the bones of the Lord, etc., by crunching on the consecrated host, something like that. The fathers were well aware that in the Eucharist we are always speaking of the risen Lord Jesus, who cannot be injured in any physical way. Therefore, it's always necessary to point out when we're trying to understand why the Council used that term, transubstantiation, that it's using substance in a philosophical sense of an underlying reality, not something like chemical or physical properties. And that's difficult for us today because we think of the word substance very differently. In any case, without denying the possibility of other ways of expressing the objective real presence of the Lord in the Eucharist, the Council did insist that transubstantiation is, to quote them, a most appropriate way of naming this conversion. And it also insisted that no one may deny that this term is appropriate. They didn't say you have to use the term, but they said you cannot deny that the term is appropriate. Note how careful they were. And they knew they were being careful. The decree on the Eucharist goes on to affirm the practice of the reservation of the Blessed Sacrament and the reverence shown to it. There's certainly a number of other significant affirmations in the decree on the sacrament, but time requires that I move on to sacrifice. 11 years later, in 1562, toward the very end of the Council, Trent issued its decree on the sacrifice of the Mass, with 8 accompanying canons. It may seem odd to us, but this was the first time that a church council issued a decree about the Eucharistic sacrifice. 13th century scholastic theologians like St. Thomas Aquinas or St. Bonaventure did not have much to say on the subject of Eucharistic sacrifice, not because it wasn't important, but because its importance was more or less taken for granted. It was not until the later Middle Ages that major theologians like, perhaps not very well known, Gabriel Biel provided significant theological reflection on this subject of the Eucharistic sacrifice. Then came Luther and the other Protestant reformers who launched a major assault on the Catholic understanding of the Eucharist as sacrifice. Luther, for one, in his famous On the Babylonian Captivity of the Church of 1520, considered the notion of Eucharistic sacrifice to be the most serious error of Catholic teaching. He said this because he argued that Catholic teaching on the Eucharistic sacrifice supported a way of our earning salvation. In other words, a good work. Our justification and reconciliation with God come by faith alone. Luther insisted on this. So do we. Moreover, he argued, in line with the letter to the Hebrews, that Christ's sacrifice for us was, as Hebrews says quite explicitly, once for all and could not be repeated. Now, admittedly, late medieval piety could give the impression that somehow we are sacrificing the Lord anew. But the Council makes it crystal clear that this is and never was the Church's teaching. To use the Council's language, the celebration of the Eucharist does not repeat the Lord's once-for-all sacrifice, but it re-presents it, and you could put a dash there, re-presents it in such a way that it can genuinely be called a sacrifice. As such, the Eucharistic sacrifice is fruitful and efficacious, says the Council, for both the living and the dead. In the course of the decree, the Council also recommends frequent reception of Holy Communion and affirms the central place of the ordained priesthood in the celebration of the Mass. As I mentioned earlier, the Council deliberately avoided getting into specific theological disputes, and therefore, except for affirming that the Mass as sacrifice is truly propitiatory, that is to say, that it truly and effectively presents our prayers before the Lord. Except for that term propitiatory, the decree does not go into the details of how the Eucharist represents the Lord's sacrifice. With regard to that issue, it was left to post-Tridentine theologians like Francisco Suarez, Robert Bellarmine, and Juan de Lugo, among others, I should add all Jesuits, among others who put forth a number of theories. Let me add that the nature of Eucharistic sacrifice is based ultimately on our understanding of the atonement, how exactly the Lord has saved us. That Christ saved us has indeed always been a firm teaching of the Church, but the Church has never explicitly decreed on the nature of the atonement, on how Christ has saved us. As a matter of fact, that subject, the atonement, continues to be a subject for vigorous and robust conversation in contemporary theology, a whole library of books. In addition to the crucial issues of real presence and Eucharistic sacrifice, the Council of Trent also dealt with issues that related directly to liturgical practice, namely the reception of communion under both kinds and the use of the vernacular language. The Council made no definitive statement with regard to either of these two issues. The Council rejected the Reformers' demands that communion be received in both kinds. It argued for the unity of the body and blood of the Lord in both species, just as Florence had done, as I mentioned in the beginning. In other words, if the consecrated bread is truly the body of the Lord, a body cannot exist without blood. That feature is called, in theological language, concomitance. Therefore, the Council declared that one cannot say that to receive only in one species should be forbidden. Receiving only in one species had been the practice for a number of centuries. Note, the Council Fathers carefully and pointedly avoided saying that the sacrament cannot be received in both kinds. It explicitly deferred to the Pope to decide the matter. A more ironic and modern ecumenical situation has allowed the Church to widen that practice, as we all know, of receiving communion in both the consecrated body and blood of the Lord. Similarly, in the midst of its polemics with the Reformers, the Council tread rather cautiously with regard to the use of the vernacular. It merely stated that no one could say that the Mass had to be able to be celebrated in the vernacular languages. Once again, note how careful they are. No one could say that the Mass had to be celebrated in the vernacular languages. Thus, the Protestant position was countered, but at the same time, those who favored the introduction of the vernacular, as did the Holy Roman Emperor at the time, Ferdinand, were left with some hope of change. Again, in a more ironic time, the Second Vatican Council was able to open the way for translating the liturgy into our own language, as we will celebrate it today. I mentioned at the beginning that Trent was a reform council. Its aim was to reform the Church in many areas, principally in the ways that clergy, including bishops, served and ministered. The Council did not intend to reform the Mass, certainly not in the way that Vatican II did. It did not intend to reform the Mass itself. That is to say, there was no intention to reform or change the basic text of what we refer to as the ordinary of the Mass, or those parts which basically do not change. What did change, and in a sense always needs to change, is the proper of the Mass, namely the texts for occasions like the inclusions of new saints, the elimination of some feasts, and the reduction of some poetic texts, like the large number of beautiful, but large number of medieval sequences like the Dies Irae, which used to be sung during requiems. These were reduced to four in the Missal of 1570. But there was a clear desire to achieve some uniformity in the celebration of the Mass as well as other liturgies, and it was left to the Pope to carry out this project. And so Pope Pius V set about preparing a unified Missal that would be used in the Roman Rite. The Roman Missal that was issued by Trent by the authority of Saint Pope Pius V, was not really a new creation. It was essentially the mass text of the first printed Missal of 1474, with the rubrics that had been added by John Burchard, Master of Ceremonies under Pope Alexander VI in 1501. This missal, in turn, basically corresponded to the use of the Roman Curia, a form of the liturgy that had been spread widely by the itinerant Franciscans ever since the 13th century. In his papal bull, entitled Quo Primum, promulgating the 1570 missal, Pope Pius V declared that this missal had been, I quote, restored according to the original norm and rite of the Holy Fathers, meaning the early church. Only those rites, like the Dominican rite and the Ambrosian rite that were older by 200 years, could be retained. We might note that such a unified missal was only made feasible by the 15th century invention of printing. That same invention made it possible for the Church of England to produce a mandatory Book of Common Prayer in 1549, and again in 1552. Let me also add that the basic form of the Mass envisioned by the Missal of Pope Pius V was what we would later come to call the Low Mass, that is, a Mass celebrated by a single priest with no singing. Provision was made for responses by the servers, but nothing was said about the faithful. Not until the Vatican II Missal. Even though the Council did not intend to reform the liturgy itself, the Fathers did recognize the need to reform some liturgical practices. In other words, to curtail a number of abuses. Following a rigorous discussion of liturgical abuses, including the character of sacred music in the summer of 1562, the following September, the Council issued the decree on matters to be observed and to be avoided in the celebration of the Mass. Now, among those abuses, the first and arguably the most prominent related to financial matters. Quote, compensations of whatever kind, bargains, importunate and unbecoming demands for payment, rather than requests for alms, end quote. Further, the Mass was not to be celebrated in private houses, but only in approved churches and oratories. Superstitions related to the fixed number of Masses or of candles used in the Mass were forbidden. But only one rather laconic statement was made with regard to sacred music. Quote, they shall also banish from the churches all such music, whether by the organ or in the singing, contains things that are lascivious or impure, end quote. Here the decree referred to the adaptation of popular music in the liturgy. Let me make a rough analogy. I hope an amusing one. It would be like adapting hip-hop music to the Mass today. Now, I'm sure if I can think of that, I'm sure somebody has tried to do it. As a matter of fact, some medieval polyphonic Masses were adapted from popular tunes, like the French, l'homme armé, the armed man, or the soldier. A number of late medieval and Renaissance composers like Josquin des Prez and Ioannis Ockeghem, and our own Palestrina, set Masses to the tune of that song. They used the basic tune to set the Kyrie and the Gloria, etc. The practice of church music had apparently fallen into some disarray by the 16th century. One of the concerns that had been expressed to Pope Paul III in 1543 in preparation for convoking the council was the fact that a number of polyphonic Mass settings were so ornate that the words were unintelligible. This concern was repeated during the council itself. But the final decree, as I have noted, was considerably more laconic, said nothing of it. Further discussions about music did take place before the final conclusion of the council in 1563. In these discussions, some of the church fathers, including the president of the council, Cardinal Moroni, did want to limit sacred music to chant or monophonic music, like the introit of the Mass that we'll hear today, as opposed to the Kyrie, the Sanctus, etc. But the Holy Roman Emperor, Ferdinand I, intervened, asking that polyphonic music be retained, so no further action was taken. The council ultimately left it to regional or provincial synods to make decisions about sacred music. The fact that subsequently Palestrina's Missa Papae Marcelli was widely considered to be a good example of music that clearly and intelligibly rendered the text of the Mass was probably responsible for a myth that started in the 17th century, so some 40 years or so later, namely that Palestrina single-handedly saved polyphonic church music for post-Tridentine Catholicism by composing this Mass, had the intention of doing that in composing this Mass. Apparently, this is not true, but that myth was solidified in a 20th century opera by Hans Pfitzner called Palestrina. To conclude, despite the inaccuracy of this myth, Palestrina's Missa Papae Marcelli remains a striking example and a monument of sublime church music. In that sense, it is a fitting tribute to the Council of Trent's great defense of the Eucharist, as well as to the Council's concern about the quality of the Mass. Thank you for your attention.
Well, thank you, Father John. I've been asked to speak a little bit about the musical side of this program, specifically to the Mass by Palestrina. I'm going to start with a reflection on Palestrina's life and his work. Then we'll move on to discussing the Missa Papae Marcelli as a vehicle for liturgical texts and how those are presented in musical forms and how they achieve that. We'll then discuss specifically how this is integrated into the Mass of the Novus Ordo, and then we'll finish with a consideration of the afterlife, the legacy of the Papae Marcelli Mass. Giovanni Pierluigi da Palestrina was known in his lifetime and beyond as the Princeps Musicum, the Prince of Music, and his church music especially was quickly established as a model of purity and perfection. He was born around 1525 in Palestrina, which then, as it is today, is a sleepy market town just outside of Rome. Following the family tradition, he took the hometown name as his surname. Little is known of his very early life, but legends recount a fascinating story that the Bishop of Palestrina heard the young Giovanni singing in the street with his friends. So enchanted was the bishop with Palestrina's beautiful voice that he invited him to join the choir at the magnificent Basilica Santa Maria Maggiore, Saint Mary Major in Rome. He's listed there as a chorister in 1537, and it was here that he was exposed to the great tradition of Gregorian plainsong, the great Franco-Flemish polyphony of the likes of Josquin des Prez, and perhaps most importantly for us, the effect of church architecture as it relates to the particular acoustical properties of the interior of those buildings. Palestrina's first professional post saw him return to his hometown as Maestro di Cappella and Sant'Abbicato, which is now known as Palestrina Cathedral, from 1544 to 1551. In 1551, he was summoned back to Rome by Pope Julius III, the very same individual who first noticed his beautiful voice all those years before. Julius appointed Palestrina Maestro di Cappella at the Cappella Giulia. This is the choir of the Chapter of Canons at St. Peter's in the Vatican. His musical reputation grew rapidly, and he was appointed as a singer at the Cappella Sistina, the Sistine Chapel, in 1555. His appointment was somewhat astonishing, not least because until this time, all the major Catholic composers had come from outside of Italy. It was also at this time that he taught music at the new Jesuit ceremony, seminary, the Collegio Romano. Unfortunately, he was dismissed from the Sistine Choir by Pope Paul IV, who apparently walked around the Vatican with sparks flying out of his shoes. This was on account, the dismissal, not the sparks, of Palestrina being married. Members of the Sistine Chapel were required to be celibate. After which, Palestrina took up a similar position at the Archbasilica of St. John Lateran. He died in 1594 as one of the most highly regarded and published composers of his time. As we've always already heard so brilliantly, the Council of Trent discussed the role of sacred music during its final session, though the topic took up only a small amount of the Council's time. Some reformers sought to restrict polyphonic music in the liturgy, claiming that the musical complexity made it impossible to understand the words. Others sought to ban sacred polyphony based on secular, popular songs of the basis, on the basis that such associations were profane and highly inappropriate. In the end, the council said little about the role of sacred music. It was really left to the local bishops to regulate the music in their own diocese. Polyphony, literally the Greek for many voices, was the primary form of musical composition during the Renaissance, whereby each voice part has its own distinct, independent musical line. For Palestrina, polyphony was ultimately the ultimate expression of the divine, the musical equivalent of heaven on earth. As we've heard, the danger of polyphony is that it can obscure the words of the sacred texts, rendering them intelligible. Unintelligible, I think that should say. The composer Agostino Agazzari wrote in 1607 that, I quote, "Music of the older kind is no longer in use because the confusion and babel of the words," end quote. He went on to say that polyphony had very nearly been banished were it not for Palestrina's remedy in the form of the Missa Papae Marcelli. The story of Palestrina's most famous Mass is indeed complex. Scored for six voice parts and published in his second book of Masses in 1567, the reality is that we really can't be sure exactly when the Mass was composed. The abbot Giuseppe Baini undertook considerable archival research in the first half of the 19th century, recording that Cardinal Borromeo had called in 1565 for the composing of La Musica Intelligibile, the music that renders the text as clearly as possible. Baini posited that the Missa Papae Marcelli was therefore written to demonstrate that polyphony could indeed convey the sense of the words with beauty, solemnity, and textual clarity. Palestrina himself seems to support this claim in the introduction to his printed edition of the Mass, noting in the dedication that these Masses were composed, and I quote, "in a new manner," close quote. Others have supported the theory that the Mass may indeed have been written in 1555 as a celebration of Pope Marcellus's election. The Kyrie Eleison and Agnus Dei movements have clear affinities with the Franco-Flemish music of Josquin des Prez and the like. But the Gloria and the Sanctus, with their near homophonic sections, stand clearly apart from the exuberant polyphony of early Renaissance masters, prioritizing the clarity of the text, often with one syllable to each musical note. Palestrina's lines are always tuned to the sense of the text. In the Sanctus, for example, we hear a series of upward leaping perfect fourths on the phrase Hosanna in excelsis, reflecting the praises resounding to God up on high. Palestrina's melodies are distinctly memorable, featuring leaps that are subsequently filled in with stepwise motion. There is something ineffably sublime about the interweaving of these melodies in the polyphony, assisted in part by the fact that the music contains very few accidentals, that is, that it exists primarily within the diatonic mode. As part of the reforms of the Second Vatican Council, the sixth chapter of its constitution of the liturgy was devoted to the consideration of liturgical music. The chapter begins with, and I quote, that liturgical tradition of the universal church is a treasury of inestimable value, close quote. Though conceptually ambiguous, the phrase surely includes the plain song, the music of Palestrina, and indeed the choirs required to perform them. The document further explains the function of liturgical music, open quote, "In the sung responses to the readings and in the Sanctus and Gloria, music itself becomes a liturgical action. It becomes liturgy, which the community accomplishes by singing or listening and with a participation that is anterior and not merely exterior," end quote. Music, including that by Palestrina, plays the part of a servant to the liturgy. It gives us time collectively to pause and to pray together. In a world that is fast-paced and frequently lacking in genuine experiences of community engagement, the singing of the choir is a much-needed balm for the soul. The St. Paul's Choir of boys and men and adults will sing the Palestrina setting of the Ordinary for the Kyrie eleison, the Gloria in Excelsis, the Sanctus, and the Benedictus in their appointed parts. Though Palestrina composed a particularly fine setting of the Credo and also of the Agnus Dei, we will speak the former and sing the latter to plain song from our own hymnal. Palestrina's Agnus Dei consists of two sections, the first of which we will sing as a motet during the ministration of communion. The sound of Palestrina's choir, though impossible to recreate for obvious reasons, they didn't have technology like this at the time, nonetheless was surely not too far from the sound of our own choir, complemented as it is by this magnificent church that exhibits acoustical properties indeed similar to those in which Palestrina worked, and of course we do have access to those magnificent acoustics still to this day. The Mass today is offered as a memorial of St. Cyril, who is a monk, and of course Methodius, the bishop, whose unusual observance today is because we have deferred it. Of course, it would normally appear yesterday on the 14th of February. The liturgical items, such as the readings and the minor propers, are particular to that celebration. The introits, for example, the text of which is sacerdotes tui domine, let your priests be clothed with righteousness, is appointed to be sung at the Mass of a confessor bishop. Likewise, the gradual, which is sung today in place of the psalm, the Alleluia, the offertory, and the communio, all have their own dedicated proper texts. The constitution of the sacred liturgy notes, and I quote, that the church recognizes Gregorian chant as especially native to the Roman liturgy. Therefore, other things being equal, it should be given pride of place in liturgical services, end quote. As such, the minor propers are sung to the traditional plain song as drawn from the Graduale Romanum. After Palestrina's departure from St. John Lateran, he considered a vocation in the priesthood. Instead, in 1581, he married Virginia Dormolli, a widow whose considerable wealth came from the fur trade and whose financial resources allowed him to self-publish much of his own music. His prodigious output comprised of 375 motets, 104 mass settings, 68 offertories, over 65 hymns, and more than 140 secular items. Palestrina's reputation as the Princeps Musicum continued to grow after his death, and he's remembered today as Italy's first great composer. His compositional style was codified in the Australian composer and theorist Johann Fuchs's 1725 volume Gradus ad Parnassum, The Steps to Parnassus, a treatise on Renaissance polyphonic composition, which was studied by the likes of Bach, Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, and indeed yours truly. Now, Missa Papae Marcelli, though unlikely to have single-handedly saved polyphony, nevertheless forged a new pathway for Renaissance music as it transitioned into the Baroque period. Its power to move audiences and congregations alike towards envisioning a sense of heaven on earth remains strong to this day, as does the clarity of the texts that are proclaimed. It is, to use a cliche, timeless. Section 113 of the Sacrosanctum Concilium asserts that the role of sacred music is understood to express, and I quote, the glory of God and the sanctification of the faithful, end quote. It is hard to imagine a more glorious embodiment of that spirit than Palestrina's Missa Papae Marcelli. Thank you.
Well, thank you both very much. I have only one question here. If somebody has a question, please put your hand up and Tiwat will come by and bring it up to me, and I hope we'll have time for it. Hand up here, Tiwat, if you could come and bring that. So, question for Father John. The Church hasn't restricted herself to one doctrine of the Atonement, but has she ruled out any of them?
That's an excellent question. No, I don't think so. It depends on what you mean about ruled out. There are many different approaches to the atonement that center on various facets of our need for salvation. One way of looking at it is that the church in the earliest period focused on our salvation from death. In the middle period, the Middle Ages, focused on our, this is not to the exclusion of the others, but on our salvation from sin. And in the modern period, it's been suggested that theories of atonement really have more to do with our salvation from alienation and meaninglessness. So there's many different approaches to the atonement, but there's no way of saying exactly what it means. We know that we use terms like redemption, salvation, but they're not. Doctrine is very careful, you see. Doctrine is very careful not to say too much. And I think there's great wisdom in that. And to, within bounds, of course, to, for example, the real presence, right, you can't go outside of those bounds, right? The true conversion of the bread and wine into the body and blood of the Lord. You can't go outside of those bounds. But you're free to speculate within those bounds as to how we can talk about that and explain it.
So I'm afraid that you're still on the dock here. So the question that's come up is the difference between consubstantiation and transubstantiation.
Okay, good. Thank you. That's an easier question to answer in some ways. The Protestants, Martin Luther, who deeply believed in the real presence, thought that, and he never used the term consubstantiation, but this is what it comes down to, that the substance of the bread and wine coexisted with the substance of the Lord's body and blood. Now, on the level of physics and chemistry, that's correct. If you take a host, of course it would be a sacrilege to do so, but if you took a consecrated host and analyzed it chemically, you would find the chemical elements of bread. I assure you. Same thing with the blood, the wine. You would find the chemical elements of wine. And if that's what consubstantiation would mean, that's fine. But that's not what St. Thomas and the others meant by transubstantiation. They meant that the true underlying reality of what appears to be bread and wine is more appropriately understood to be, believed to be, the body and blood of the Lord. It was a way of affirming the reality of the objective transformation or change of the elements. And so the church rejects the idea of consubstantiation, though substance means two different things in both of those mentalities.
All right, so in masses like these, the Benedictus and Agnus Dei are often very long for the Novus Ordo Mass. How can this best be worked with liturgically and musically?
Well, that's a great question, and the Vatican II Council dealt with this notion of how to integrate the Sanctus, which of course would have been sung by the choir during which the liturgical action was performed in silence and often out of view. How do we integrate these long settings that really were there to cover the action rather than to highlight it in some ways? How do we integrate those? And there is no real easy answer. The council didn't have an answer, and there have been many, many, many wonderful discussions of how to solve this problem, like Maria. How do we solve this problem of the pre-existing Sanctus and Benedictus settings by Haydn and by Mozart and by Palestrina and by Lassus, this great tradition, this treasury of sacred music that the council actively reveres and seeks to be promulgated and continued through the work of the church. So it's a very difficult place to be, and I think the key is don't do it all the time in a very practical way. as music director, my job is to be practical with these considerations, and I think the idea is don't do this all the time, and it makes people then able to take the give and take and the sort of the push and pull of the liturgy without interrupting it and stopping it short of the liturgical action it's now become. If that makes sense.
Good. I think we're at 5:20, so we're going to end here. Thank you both for your talks, for the answers to questions, and everything that we learned from them. So.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Friends, being gathered together by the Lord's own love, we turn to him now, asking for his pardon, for his peace. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, brothers and sisters. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us all to everlasting life.
Thank you. or in excelsis Deo.
Let us pray. O God, who enlightened the Slavic peoples through the brothers Saints Cyril and Methodius, grant that our hearts may grasp the words of your teaching and perfect us as a people of God. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, our Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of the Acts of the Apostles. Paul and Barnabas spoke out boldly and said, "It was necessary that the word of God be spoken to you first. But since you reject it and condemned yourself as unworthy of eternal life, we now turn to the Gentiles. For the Lord so commanded us, 'I have made you a light to the Gentiles, that you may be an instrument of salvation to the ends of the earth.'" The Gentiles were delighted when they heard this and glorified the word of the Lord. All who were destined for eternal life came to believe, and the word of the Lord continued to spread through the whole region. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. The Lord Jesus appointed 72 other disciples, whom he sent ahead of him in pairs, to every town and place he intended to visit. He said to them, "The harvest is abundant, but the laborers are few. So ask the master of the harvest to send out laborers for his harvest. Go on your way. Behold, I am sending you like lambs among wolves. Carry no money bag, no sack, no sandals, and greet no one along the way. Into whatever house you enter, first say, 'Peace to this household.' And if a peaceful person lives there, your peace will rest upon him. But if not, it will return to you. Stay in the same house and eat and drink what is offered to you, for the laborer deserves his payment. And do not move from one house to another. Whatever town you enter and they welcome you, eat what is set before you, cure the sick in it, and say to them, 'The kingdom of God is at hand for you.'" The Gospel of the Lord. In today's gospel, Jesus appoints a group of 72 disciples to precede him on his journey and prepare the way. This will be the first proclamation of his message outside the Jewish homeland. They go into Samaria, a land whose people are likely to be unfriendly and uncomprehending before the good news that Jesus is preaching. Jesus here presents this mission of the 72 as a model for spreading the gospel in the future, ultimately to the ends of the earth. So what does this model show us? Proclaiming the gospel is a big task, needing many laborers who must work together. They bring healing and peace to all who are prepared to receive them. They announce the coming kingdom of God, a reality where God's loving will is truly fulfilled in everyday acts of charity and justice, in living the life we truly long for. But those who proclaim this reality may be met with incomprehension and resistance. Part of that barrier is language itself. Now, at Pentecost, the assembled crowd from all over the world spoke a babble of different tongues. But when God's Holy Spirit entered them, each one fully understood the good news in his own language. The Holy Spirit speaks directly to every human mind and heart. But the world is still divided by so many tongues that are unintelligible to each other. In the everyday world of proclaiming the gospel, we must learn to make this message of joy and hope intelligible in every language and culture on earth. A task for many laborers indeed. And there have been no greater laborers in spreading the light of the gospel than Saints Cyril and Methodius, whose memorial we celebrate today. Their feast day actually was yesterday, but Father Kelly has moved our parish celebration to today so that we could celebrate them in this liturgy together with Palestrina's glorious music. Their work of evangelization specifically included an immense contribution to communication in language. Cyril and Methodius were brothers born to a prominent family in the early 800s in Thessaloniki, in present-day Greece, then part of the Byzantine Empire. The Apostle Paul had preached there, and his two letters to the Thessalonians are in the New Testament canon. Thessaloniki in the year 800 was a bilingual city. Greek was the literary, administrative, and liturgical language. But there was also a widely spoken dialect related to present-day Serbian and other Slav languages like Czech and Russian. And this Slav dialect was only a spoken language. It had no alphabet, no writings of any kind. But Cyril and Methodius both spoke it fluently. While they were still young men, the Byzantine emperor received an embassy from a central European prince in what is now the Czech Republic, asking for missionaries to plant Christianity more firmly among a people until then only partly evangelized. Though the destination was far outside the empire itself, the emperor complied and sent Cyril and Methodius with a small team to this far territory. The people to whom they sent, to whom they were sent spoke a Slavic dialect that was basically intelligible to the Slav-speaking brothers. In order to share the gospel, they created a new alphabet and so turned their own Slavic speech into a written language for the first time. And this is the language that came to be known as Slavonic. And the alphabet, as it later developed, was named after Cyril, the Cyrillic alphabet. And in the following centuries, this written language spread throughout Eastern Europe and into Russia, becoming a language of literature and scholarship and government, as well as a language of worship. So Cyril and Methodius gave a gift of incomparable value to human culture. But in their lifetime, these saints did the work of creating a written language for a higher purpose. They sought through this language to make the gospel intelligible, so as to invite their hearers into a life of blessedness with God's Son. And so with the help of a team of assistants, they translated the Bible, the Mass, and other church books into a Slavonic language of great clarity and beauty. People understood. They were moved. Lives changed. The kingdom of God, the reality of healing and peace preached by those 72 missionaries Jesus sent out, that kingdom came nearer through the labors of Saints Cyril and Methodius. Inspired by them today, may the kingdom of God, through the prayers of our own Eucharistic liturgy, overcome our own resistance and enter into our hearts and minds with that sweet clarity. And here, we are doubly blessed that Palestrina, another great laborer in the work of spreading the gospel, has given us music to deepen and extend the understanding that we attain through language. And in his music, sung with so much inspiration by our choir, the words of our worship are borne aloft with a transcendent clarity and beauty. And the music itself flies beyond the words to evoke the ineffable mystery of a loving God who gave himself for us and whose Son is wholly present here in his body and blood.
Believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of all things, whole and evil. Father, before all ages, God, like Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became Let us pray to Christ, the Good Shepherd, through the intercession of St. Cyril and Methodius.
For all who proclaim the word of God, for missionaries both far away and among us, let us pray to the Lord. For all who have not heard the good news, and for those whose minds and hearts are blocked against it, let us pray to the Lord. For composers, musicians, and choirs, in their labor to make music a vehicle of the gospel, and especially the St. Paul's Choir School, let us pray to the Lord. For a deepening of faith in the Eucharistic presence of Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
To pray that the Lord will bring them to eternal glory, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Loving Father, we raise these prayers to you now. We ask that they be strengthened by the intercession of our Blessed Mother, as together we pray.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou.
Friends, we will not be having an offertory collection today, but at the end of Mass, if you would like to leave an offering in the baskets, that will help us to continue programs such as this. Thank you. Please be seated. Please pray, friends, that my sacrifice and yours may be made acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Look, O Lord, upon the offerings which we bring before your majesty in commemoration of Saints Cyril and Methodius, and grant that these gifts may become the sign of a new humanity, reconciled to you in loving charity, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For in the marvelous confession of your saints, you make your church fruitful with strength ever new, and offer us sure signs of your love. And that your saving mysteries may be fulfilled, their great example lends us courage, their fervent prayers sustain us in all we do. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, as in exultation we acclaim.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. When
we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the death of the Lord until you come.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Sean our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
And in him, O God, mighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory
at the Savior's command and formed by his divine teaching, we dare to say,
"Our Father, who art in heaven,
deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom of God.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer one another this sign of peace.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, Father of all nations, who make us sharers in the one bread and the one spirit and heirs of the eternal banquet, grant in your kindness on this feast day of Saints Cyril and Methodius that the multitude of your children, persevering in the same faith, may be united in building up the kingdom of justice and peace through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you all once again for being here with us this evening. A thank you to Deacon Tim and the Harvard Catholic Forum, to Father Baldovin and Mr. Kennerley for their words before the Mass, and to the choir for leading us in this beautiful music. If you're able, after Mass, please know that you are welcome to join us in the Harvard Catholic Student Lounge for some conversation and for some coffee. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.